I'd like to express my sincere gratitude to JNDD and TMT Post Media Group for the invitation. It's a pleasure to be here in THX Summit, sharing my viewpoint about financial and capital market and blockchain. My name is Naoyuki Iwashita, and I teach fintech at Kyoto University. I mainly lecture to graduate students on fintech from the various viewpoints, such as economics, legal, and information technology. Bitcoin and crypto as a crypto asset received worldwide attention in 2017 as they soared. They went through a series of market swings since then. Still, even now, in July 2020, it maintains the market capitalization of about $270 billion. Facebook published a white paper on Libra in June 2019, which attracted worldwide attention. China's digital yuan demonstration began this year. Countries around the world are researching central bank digital currencies, or CBDC. The change from fiat currency to virtual currency or crypto asset, and the shift from the legal tender confined to one country to an international available digital currency. People's understanding of money is changing dramatically. Yet, when we think about that, this change seems to be somewhat of exaggerated sales talk. People are still receiving their paycheck in traditional bank deposit. Bitcoin, touted as money in the future, is still not being used in stores. A digital currency that can be used for international payment has not yet been issued in reality. I do not say that these are merely all falsehood. Instead, there might be a significant technological innovation and a social transformation that cannot be reversed. In my speech, I will discuss how information technology innovation will change the financial and capital market in future. Blockchain is the underlying technology of crypto asset, such as Bitcoin. In 2008, a mysterious person claiming to be Satoshi Nakamoto published a paper titled Bitcoin, a peer-to-peer electronic cash system. Satoshi began experiment in 2009 by releasing an actual working program. Bitcoin was an experimental project that aimed to enable anonymous money transfers between individuals. Rather than start a company, Satoshi invited volunteers to participate in the experiment over the internet, and Bitcoin community naturally expanded. Bitcoin is a decentralized system by using peer-to-peer network. On the contrary, financial institutions use server-based network. Financial institutions store electronic data of outstanding balance of bank deposit and securities in dedicated central server and strictly protected. The banking system and central securities depository, or CSD, plays a role in this progress. However, Bitcoin is built on about 10 1,000 computers in all over the world connected to the internet. The sharing the same data in 10,000 machines achieves the same stability as a strictly protected central server system. Since Bitcoin is decentralized, there is no need for an expensive central server. This was an evolutionary idea. If this technology replaces the existing financial system, it will change the financial and capital market dramatically. Nevertheless, a system without a central server would find it challenging to prevent double transfer of asset effectively. A central server could be put in place to check double transfer, but it violates the decentralization philosophy. It also would be costly to maintain the central server security, and as a result, that wouldn't be much different from the current system, central server system of financial institutions. Bitcoin has uniquely solved this problem. They have decided to allow any users who join the network to participate in the verification of their transactions. However, in that case, user who has made a double transfer might become a verifier by himself and approving his own unauthorized transactions. As countermeasure to that risk, Bitcoin is using a method called competitive mining. Anyone who seek to verify the transaction must solve a computationally intensive task about once every 10 minutes. The first one to answer the correctly would be the verifier. The mining companies in all over the world have set up mining factories to compute the task. They compete with each other. Satoshi thought that such participants, a winner of the competition, could be trusted as a verifier if he could carry such a load. This is called proof of work. The winner of competition generates a new block chained to the block created by previous verifier. At the same time, he gets a certain amount of new Bitcoin. Bitcoin has been operating for more than a decade with no support from anywhere, although it has no corporate structure and unknown central figure. If you look at the inside of the technology, you will see that the blockchain technology employed by Bitcoin is not a magic stick, magic wand that can be used for any purpose. The Bitcoin blockchain is often called permissionless blockchain. Anybody who wants to take part in the Bitcoin blockchain network, no permission is needed. There has been proposal for permissioned blockchain. There are someone in the center of the permission blockchain. He or she limits the participants and place the sole role of verifier. They do not involve competitive mining, although they use the chaining block like Bitcoin. There isn't so much different than a system with the existing central server system. Because of the lack of the central system, Bitcoin has been able to overcome the differences of regulatory and political system worldwide. Unlike Bitcoin, digital currencies such as Libra and CDBC, employ permissioned blockchain. It may not be trusted across borders. If any country holds a central system, the country's government might freeze a particular user's asset for political reasons. This makes it challenging to create something in between the legal tender, in between the Bitcoin and the legal tender. Next, I would like to talk about ICO and STO. As Bitcoin soared, thousands of crypto asset projects were proposed from around the world. Among those new crypto assets, a number of them soared. In particular, Ethereum became the second largest crypto asset. It was used as a platform to issue ERC-20 token. The method of raising funds by issuing these tokens is called ICO, or initial coin offering. Tokens do not have the right to receive the dividend or participate in management like stock, nor are tokens redeemable at maturity like bonds. They are a type of crypto asset that has no known value. Let's take a look at the ICO's growth in this impressive chart created by the Elementus. Each balloon of different size represents each ICO project. The size of each balloon shows the amount of money they raised. You can see the bar chart at the bottom of this screenshot. This bar chart indicates the value of the ICO fundraising for each month. ICO increased rapidly in 2017, and by 2018, ICO has successfully raised some $25 billion worldwide. But from the mid 2018, ICO declined dramatically. And for these 15 months, ICO projects have been mostly unsuccessful. The reason why ICO has declined is that it has failed to meet the expectation of investors. This table shows a comparison of the advanced return of tokendata.io. Here's the top 10 token, which is still in circulation today. According to this site, except for the infrequent success stories like Tezos, in many ICO projects, token price dropped around 80 or 19%, and investors lost much money. In the term of ICO was coined from the word IPO. At first glance, they look alike. However, IPO is regulated by securities law in each country. And there is a framework for listing examination in each stock exchange. On the other hand, such regulation and framework do not exist for ICO. Anyone who publishes his business plan as a white paper might have raised funds, even though his project has no substance. If ICO token issuers developed a superior product or service, then we can consider that ICO would have a raison d'etre. But in reality, they didn't do that. Many of issuers that got a lot of money just writing a white paper did not make any effort to get their business off the ground, investors also thought only about reselling tokens at high price in the secondary market, and they are not interested in whether the ICO business plan would succeed in or not. As a result, many ICO projects didn't develop anything and just disappeared. Eventually, the ICO boom was gone. In response to these various problems, regulators in many countries have begun to regulate ICO. In the US, the SEC has announced that some ICO projects constitute an offering of securities under the US securities law. Some token issuers have admitted to the SEC that their tokens are securities and asked the SEC to apply for the exemption under Regulation D. This kind of token issuance is called STO or Security Token Offering. China's financial authorities issued a directive banning ICO in September 2017. Japan has similarly tightly regulated ICO in 2017. From the viewpoint of the investors' protection, I believe that the effort of China and Japan are appropriate. In Japan, the amended Financial Instrument and Exchange Law, which incorporate ICO regulation, came into force this May. Under the amended law, profit sharing ICO is subject to the securities law. Some people call this the Japanese version STO. In new Japanese law, token intermediaries are required to examine the issuer's business and financial status. The amendment of the law in Japan was intended to solve the problem of ICO with securities regulation, but as a result, it has made it possible to introduce blockchain technology to traditional securities market. Nevertheless, blockchain technology is not a magic wand in this area either. We need to carefully consider whether this new technology will lead the financial market to real convenience and efficiency rather than regulatory arbitrage. Thank you very much for your attention.